فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu reported that Allah's Apostle sallallahu alayhi wasallam is saying, the fire which sons of Adam burn is only 1/70th part of the fire of hell. His companion said, by Allah, even ordinary fire would have been enough. Thereupon he said, it is 69 parts in excess of fire in this world, each of them being equivalent to their heat.
عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال ناركم هذه التي يوقد بنو آدم جزء واحد من 70 جزءا من حر جهنم. قالوا والله إن كانت لكافية يا رسول الله. قال فإنها فضلت ب99 جزءا كلهن مثل حر كلهن مثل حرها.
This hadith talks about the heat of Jahannam and how hot Jahannam is. And when narrations like this come to a believer, it really scares him. You know what he does? He feels worried and concerned and fearful. I don't know if amongst us anyone is able to endure that pain. Especially when they hear this hadith where the Prophet ﷺ says, نَارُكُمْ هَذِهِ this fire which you're using, this world, this fire that we cook with, the volcanoes and all of that which we have, الَّذِي يُوقِدُ بَنُ آدَمَ that the children of Adam use, جُزْءٌ وَاحِدٌ is just a portion, means سَبْعِينَ جُزْءًا from 70 portions of مِنْ حَرِّ جَهَنَّمَ the heat of the hellfire. قَالُوا وَاللَّهِ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ إِنْ كَانَ ذَكَافِيَةً يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ O Messenger of Allah, it is enough. Then the Prophet said, فَإِنَّهَا فُضِّلَتْ It was given virtue, it was made more. بِتِسْعَةٍ وَسَتِينَ جُزْءًا كُلُّهُنَّ مِثْلُ حَرِّهَا Anyone who knows Jahannam doesn't sleep easily and lives a life of worry and fear. Scared. I have a book in my house, it's called At-Takhwif min Nari Jahannam. At-Takhwif, to be scared of the hellfire. It's written by Ibn Rajab al-Habib. When you read that book, you realize, subhanAllah, we are in one place, and what's being prepared is where it's on another side. We're not even on the same wave of the reality that we suffer on the other side. Allah tells us in the Quran, وَأَصْحَابُ الشِّمَالِ مَا أَصْحَابُ الشِّمَالِ There are people who are going to be on the left. The people of deviation and the people of corruption. The people of the hellfire. Allah says to us, فِي سَمُومٍ وَحَمِيمٍ They are in the midst of the heat, and the burning, and the lava of Jahannam. They're going to burn inside it. There's no comfort, there is no ease for them. Those people in the hellfire. Allah tells us, كُلَّمَا نَضِجَتْ جُلُودُهُمْ Every single time their skin peels off because of the heat. Allah says, سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى بَدَّلْنَاهُمْ جُلُودًا غَيْرَهَا لِيَضُوفُ الْعَذَابِ Every time they get burnt in the hellfire and their skin peels off, Allah says, we give them a new set of skin so they can taste the hellfire very well. It's a continuous pattern. It's not one time, two times. Youngsters, brothers were young. Youngsters in the back, you're sitting in the back. Come close, brothers. Mashallah, so for this. So often it's the cooling, it's in the hadith. How can I so for this? Who's the house? Youngsters, brothers, listen to this hadith. And I know Allah has protected you guys, inshallah. This is your problem. Listen to this particular hadith and tell those who know some family members and people who are naughty, who are following what Allah has told them. Listen to this hadith. Jabir ibn Abdullah narrated that the Prophet said, Inna ala Allahi ahdan, Allah made a covenant. Allah made an oath. Allah made a promise. لِمَنْ شَرِبَ مُسْكِرًا Anyone who drinks alcohol. Whoever takes drugs. This is just to talk to other people. Everyone who knows somebody who's up to this, tell them this. The Prophet said, إِنَّا عَلَى اللَّهِ It is upon Allah. It's a promise Allah made. It's an ahd, it's an oath, it's a covenant. What is it? لِمَنْ شَرِبَ مُسْكِرًا Anyone who drinks alcohol. Or anything that intoxicates, drugs falls under this. Liyaskiya, Allah is going to make him, is going to make him taste. Min tini al-khabal. The companions, they said, Ya Rasulullah, wa ma tinatu al-khabal. What's that? The Prophet said, Araqu ahli al-nar, the people of the hellfire, the sweat that comes off them, and that which comes from their skin, from the burning, they will have to drink that. You chose to drink in this world alcohol. You chose to take drugs and place it in yourself. When you go to Jahannam, you're going to taste the sweat after you're burning in hell. You're already in there. Your skin is peeling, it's burning, it's going through your flesh, it's going through your bones. What's happening to you? What's happening to you is you're now forced to drink the filth and the waste of the people of hellfire. Usaratu ahlillah. And this is jaza'u wifaqa. It's in response to exactly the sin that you have accumulated and that you have done. So then those people who are taking drugs, they live in a very hard life in this world. They live in a very hard life. Brothers, I know a brother who came from Egypt, studied Arabic. Came back to the UK and he got arrested. But when he came back straight away, he was here for a while. He went on the streets and he started to sell drugs. He got caught and he got given 9 years. He's behind bars for 9 years. His parents sent him to another country to learn Arabic, to learn the religion every single day. My brother came up to me and said, Ahi, came out of prison. So I said, how is prison like? What is it like? What's the Muslim? How are they in number? And he told me, the percentage of young Muslims in prison is rising. It's so high, it's ridiculous. The young Somali kids that are in prison because of drugs, this and that, it's ridiculous. You heard the other day what happened in North Mohawk. A young 19-year-old kid, 19, imagine, look at the parent, the pain that they have to endure. 19-year-old son of theirs, they raised from the ground onwards. They raised this child, they fed him, they gave him shelter, they gave him food. What that mother has to go through knowing her son, but the father, what he has to go through. I've got kids, wallahi. I cannot imagine after 10, 20 years, think to myself, my child's now at that age. I find out he gets killed. 20 years of my life is gone. Is that fair on your parents? Wallahi, it's not fair. It's not fair on your parents, it's not fair on yourself. And it truly is something you're going to suffer in this world before the hereafter. You're going to suffer. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, youngsters, brothers, I know a lot of us, we do this because we're looking for reputation and name. Allah says in the Quran, تِلْكَ الدَّارُ الْآخِرَةِ نَجْعَلُهَا لِلَّذِينَ لَا يُرِيدُونَ عُلُوًّا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَا فَسَادًا وَالْعَاقِبَةُ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. The hereafter is made for the one who doesn't want to be high and big in this world. It's not, Jannah is not for those people. Jannah are for the simple, easy, soft-hearted, easy people. There was a story I read a couple of months ago when I was teaching Thalathatul Rasul. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, the leader, pay attention to this. He's a righteous leader. He's rich. He runs the Muslim world. He has the biggest treasurer in the world. He has money. The treasurer is full of money. Him and his wife are living a simple life. One day, Fatima bint Abd al-Malik ibn Marwan. She was in a room. A woman came in. She saw Fatima not wearing a hijab and a man was in the room. So the woman looks at Fatima. Fatima bint Abd al-Malik. You have to remember who this woman is as well. This is the wife of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. Her father was a leader, Abd al-Malik ibn Marwan. Her brother Sulaiman is a leader. Her other brother Khalid is a leader. Her husband is a leader. She's from a family of rich, wealthy money. She was raised like that. So she's in a room with a man in the room. A woman enters onto her, but Fatima's not wearing hijab. So the woman comes in and she says to Fatima, Fatima, why is it that you're not wearing a hijab? There's a man in the room. Cover yourself up. So she looks at her and she says, the man you see is none other than Umar ibn Abdul Aziz himself. That's what he was doing. He was cleaning the house. He was painting the house. He was working on the house. His appearance changed. That man was rich. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz was extremely rich before he took leadership. When he took the leadership, he got rid of everything which he owned. And he made sure he cleaned out his closet. Radiallahu ta'ala anhu wa rahimah. So one day he came to his wife Fatima and he reminded her of the days when they used to be rich, the days when they had money, the days when they were enjoying themselves. And so Fatima looked at Umar ibn Abdul Aziz and she said to Umar, Umar, you're able to bring that back for us. You're able to make us enjoy ourselves like we used to enjoy ourselves back in those days. You can do that. You've got the treasures of the Muslims. You've got the keys. Why don't you make us enjoy ourselves? Why don't you bring that money for us? And look what he said to her in response. Pay attention, youngsters, brothers, all of us. He responded and he turned back at her and he said, Inni akhaf Allah. I fear Allah. I am scared of a day in which I meet Allah tabarak wa ta'ala and I get accounted. I can give it to you. I can make you enjoy yourself. And I fear Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz died reciting the verse that I mentioned a couple of minutes ago. تلك الدار الآخرة نجعلها للذين لا يريدون علوا في الأرض ولا فسادا والعاقبة والعاقبة للمتقين. This is the ayah that I need to recite it. That this world, if you want the hereafter, you're not going to look for to be higher. Ikhwani, the Prophet told us, من خاف أدلج. Anyone who is scared, are we scared of the day, that fire that has been mentioned here? Are we scared? Are we really worried about it? When the Prophet said, "Man khafa adlaj," the person who is scared prepares. وَمَنْ أَدْلَجَ بَلَغَ الْمَنْزِلِ أَلَا إِنَّ سِبْعَةَ اللَّهِ غَالِيَةَ أَلَا إِنَّ سِبْعَةَ اللَّهِ جَنَّةَ. The Prophet said, the one who is scared, who is truly scared, he prepares. Wallahi, he prepares. The one who is scared, it's impossible for him to do sins. To commit sins, to go against Allah Ta'ala's command and say, I'm scared. It's impossible that a person is scared and they leave off things that are obligatory and they know that person is truly not scared. We have to wake up reading our life. And that's the truth. If we're preparing for a day in which it's severe punishment, is serious. There's a fariqun fil jannah, a group who are going to enter Jannah. Wa fariqun fil sa'ir. A group is going to enter Jannah and a group is going to enter the hellfire. Then our eyes shouldn't mean just enjoy itself. وَلِذَلِكَ عُمَرُ بْنَ عَبْدِ الْعَزِيزِ himself used to say, وَكَيْفَ تَنَامُ عَيْنٌ وَهِيَ قَلِيرَةٌ وَلَمْ تَدْرِ فِي أَيِّ الْمَحَلَيْنِ يَنْزِلُ. Which person can his eyes just go to sleep at night, just sleep, enjoy himself? وَلَمْ تَدْرِ, and he doesn't really know, فِي أَيِّ الْمَحَلَيْنِ يَنْزِلُ. He doesn't know which of the two stations is going to be put in. Is he going to be fariqun fi jannah or is he going to be fariqun fi sa'ir? He doesn't know. But then one of the a'immah to salaf said, his mother entered onto him and he was crying severely. He was crying severely. And his mother entered onto him and she said to him, my son, why are you crying every single night like this? If you've killed a person, then we will go to that family, we'll ask for forgiveness. And surely from when they see your situation and the way you are, wallahi, they will ask for your forgiveness. Because they won't hold your account. You spend day and night crying. He said to his mother, Mom, na'am, I have. I killed myself. He says, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the Quran, وَإِن مِنْكُمْ إِلَّا وَارِدُهَا كان على ربك حتما مقضيا ثم ننجي الذين اتقوا ونذر الظالمين فيها جثيا. The hellfire, everyone's going to go over it. It's a bridge. The Prophet told us there's kanaleen. There are metal rods on the side. It grabs people. The one who had come with prayer, the one who came with righteous actions, the salah will come to you that day and it will say to come, I'll take you out of this place. And it will take him. The messenger will be the first to go and he will go through like a lightning, as he said, alayhi salatu wasalam. The rest are different stages. One person is going to be told to walk on that sirat. His legs are going to cut. Another one, he can't walk because his actions are very little, so he's going to crawl. Another one, the Prophet told us, is going to go on his stomach. And when he falls, Jahannama is right under him. So he falls into the hellfire. And Allah told us the only people who are not going to fall from that bridge are who? The pious people. The people who are righteous. Al-Taqwa. The people of Al-Taqwa is the one Ali ibn Abi Talib, he said, Al-Khawf min al-Jaleel, wal-Amal bil-Tanzeel, wal-Ridha bil-Qaleel, wa-Istidadu li-Yawm al-Rahim. He said, this is what taqwa is. Al-Khawf min al-Jaleel is to fear Allah. Wal-Amal bil-Tanzeel is to implement the Kitab and the Sunnah. Al-Amal bil-Tanzeel. Wal-Ridha bil-Qaleel, and to be happy with the little Allah gave you. وَاسْتِعْدَادُ لِيَوْمِ الرَّحِيلَ is to prepare for the day when you stand in front of him. That day, wallahi, the Prophet told us, لَيْسَ بَيْنَكَ وَبَيْنَ اللَّهِ تُرْجُمَانِ. There is no translator between you and Allah. Here you can get a lawyer, and the lawyer may get out and get you out of the problems. لَيْسَ بَيْنَكَ وَبَيْنَ اللَّهِ تُرْجُمَانِ. The Prophet told us that the person will look towards his right. فَيَنْظُرَ أَيْمَنَ مِنْهُ فَلَا يَرَى إِلَّا مَا قَدَّمْ. The person will look towards his right and he'll only see what he put forward. وَيَنْظُرَ أَشْبَعَ مِنْهُ. The person will look towards his left. فَلَا يَرَى إِلَّا مَا قَدَّمْ. And he'll only see the things that he has done. Then the Prophet said, فَيَنْظُرَ بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ. The person looks right in front of him. فَيَرَى النَّارَ تِلْقَاءَ وَجْهِ. He sees the hellfire right at him, looking at him in the eyes. The messenger told us, brothers, لَهَا سَبْعُونَ زِبْزِبَابٌ. جَهَنَّمَ has 17 ropes. لِكُلِّ زِبَابٍ 70,000. لِكُلِّ زِبَابٍ each row. سَبْعُونَ أَلْفَ مَلَكٍ يَجُرُّونَهَا. 70 angels, each row holding it down, trying to make sure that Jahannam doesn't run to the people. It's roaring. Allah says, إِذَا رَأَتُم مِّن مَكَانٍ بَعِيدٍ سَمِعُوا لَهَا تَغَيُّضًا وَزَفِيرًا. It roars when it sees its people, the people who are meant to enter it. Jahannam is not something you want to put yourself into. Allah looks at Jahannam and he says to Jahannam, after he put everybody in there and he filled it up ala qa'riha, Allah says to it, Halim talat, are you full, Jahannam? Do you have everything you needed? And then Jahannam says, Hal min mazid, is there more for me to take in? Fayadu Rabb, your Lord places his foot inside it. Fayanzawi ba'duhu ba'da, Jahannam swallows and eats itself. There's nothing else able to fill Jahannam up. It can't get full. The messenger was sitting with his companions one day. فَسَمِعُوا صَوْتًا. They heard a noise. Something fell. And then the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said to the companions, did you hear that noise? And they said, Ya Rasulullah, we heard that noise. The messenger said it was something that was thrown from the edge of Jahannam. And it was going down. And now it just reached the bottom. Right now, it reached the bottom. Ayyuhal ahibba, my beloved brothers and sisters, those of you who have belief and faith in your heart, those who believe that they're going to go back to Allah, and they're going to meet Him subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they're going to be accounted for everything which they said and they did, make sure you save your bones, your flesh, your skin from that fire. And the way you can do it is not rocket science. It's simple and it's easy. It's achievable. And the way you can do it is amal salih, righteous actions. Righteous actions today. Your opportunity is today, youngsters. Your life and your opportunity is today. I've been to the hospital recently. I've seen people in hospital. I've seen elderly people. I even one time saw a young boy in hospital. Young boy. Ikhwan, when death comes, it doesn't consult you. And it doesn't take your opinion. it will come unexpectedly and it will take you. And that day, that action that I just told you is going to save you with Allah's mercy added onto it. Allah tells us in the Quran, your book will be given to you, and then when you read your book, you will say, مَا لِهَذَا الْكِتَابِ لَا يُغَادِرُ صَغِيرَةً وَلَا كَبِيرَةً إِلَّا أَحْصَاهَا وَوَجَدُوا مَا عَمِلُوا حَاضِرًا وَلَا يَظْلِمُ رَبُّكَ أَحَدًا. The person will open their book and they will read and they will see everything which they said, everything which they did, present in that book of theirs. And then they will say in response, مَا لِهَذَا الْكِتَابِ, what book is this? لَا يُغَادِرُ صَغِيرَةً وَلَا كَبِيرَةً إِلَّا أَحْصَاهَا. The little and the much, it doesn't leave off anything. Every single thing is present in it. It's not letting go of anything. That's what that book is going to have in it. Allahumma salli ya Rabbil Alameen. Oh Allah, give us safety. Oh Allah, protect our youngsters and our youth and bring them back to the reality out there. Oh Allah, make them understand that the problem that awaits them, it's a day where your mother's going to run away from you. You have no parents that can care for you. يَوْمَ يَفِرُّ الْمَرْءُ مِنْ أَخِيهِ وَأُمِّهِ وَأَبِيهِ وَصَاحِبَتِهِ وَبَنِيهِ. The child, the parent, your mother today is the only one. If you become a criminal, you've got a life sentence in prison, she's probably the only one that's going to go visit you in prison. She's the one that loves you the most. She's the one that admires you. It's the only one who, when you do something wrong, she'll always find an excuse for you. That's how the mother is. To everybody else, that day even she will run away from you. Even she doesn't have anything to say for you. That day everyone is for their own self. Everyone is out there for themselves. So don't expect for your friends and the people you've chosen to help you that day. Allahumma salli ya Rabbil Alameen. Oh Allah, give us safety that day. Oh Allah, enter us Jannah. Ikhwani, entering Jannah is not the only thing that the Prophet ﷺ told us to look for. The believer doesn't have that kind of aspiration alone. We ask Allah, he takes us to Jannah to Firdaus. And he makes us those who see Allah tabarak wa ta'ala and that look at him. إِنَّهُ وَلِيُّ ذَٰلِكَ وَالْقَادِرُ عَلَيْهِ. Allah is the one who is able to do that. And all of this, as I said to you, my beloved brothers, as we said, this is تَذْكِرَةً وَمَتَاعًا لِلْمُقْوِينَ. It's a reminder. And it's a reminder to the people who are alive. إِنَّ فِي ذَٰلِكَ لَذِكْرًا لِمَنْ كَانَ لَهُ قَلْبٌ أَوْ أَلْقَى السَّمْعَ وَهُوَ شَهِيدٌ. All of these are giving you these reminders. It doesn't affect everybody. Some people might hear it and it might go over there. Some might even wish to just go out of the masjid because it doesn't really affect them. It only affects the one whose heart is alive. Oh Allah, keep our hearts alive. لِمَنْ كَانَ لَهُ قَلْبٌ أَوْ أَلْقَى السَّمْعَ وَهُوَ شَهِيدٌ. He has a heart. And his heart is alive. And he hears. May Allah give us those who hear the truth and follow it.
Al-Aghar al-Muzani radiyallahu anhu narrated that Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, O people, seek repentance from Allah. Verily, I seek repentance from Him 100 times a day.
An Aghar ibn Yasar al-Muzani radiyallahu anhu qal, qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya ayyuhan nasu, tubu ila Allah. فإني أتوب في اليوم إليه 100 مرة.
إخواني أنا خواتي, my beloved brothers and sisters, repentance. This hadith shows us the obligation of repentance and that we all need to repent. Al-Aghar ibn Yasar al-Muzani says that the Prophet ﷺ said, أيها الناس, O people, توبوا إلى الله, repent to Allah. فإني أتوب في اليوم إليه 100 مرة. The Prophet says, I seek refuge. So I repent to Allah every day 100 times. That's the message of Allah. 100 times a day, he repents to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even that though his past sins, his upcoming sins are all forgiven, alayhi salatu wasalam. لِيَغْفِرَ لَكَ اللَّهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِكَ وَمَا تَأَخَّرَ. Allah forgave him for all his sins, clean. بَعْدَلِكَ, he used to repent, alayhi salatu wasalam, 100 times a day. So brothers, وَتُوبُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا أَيُّهَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. Repent to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, prosperity and success lies in it. Allah also says, وَأَنِسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ إِنَّهُ وَأَنِسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ ثُمَّ تُوبُوا إِلَيْهِ. ask your Lord for forgiveness and repent to Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah loves when you repent to Him. Allah loves repentance more than a person who goes to the middle of the desert. Allahu afrahu bi tawbati ahadikum. Allah is more happier to one of you's repentance than a person who goes to the middle of the desert. He goes to the middle of the desert. He has a riding beast. He places his food, his provision, everything on his riding beast. And then what happens is that the riding beast gets lost, or he can't find it. He goes to sleep, wakes up, his riding beast is gone. His riding beast is gone. So what happens is that he finds his riding beast after a while. He gets ready for death. He gets himself ready for the grave that he's going to go to. And then he finds his beast over his head. How would that person be? How happy would he be? If he finds his camel right on top of him, after getting ready for death. The Prophet told us that he gets so happy that he says to Allah, "Anta abdi wa ana rabbuk akhta min shiddati farah." He does a mistake out of due to excessive happiness. And he says, "Oh Allah, you're my slave, not your master." He makes that mistake out of the excessive happiness. Allah is more happier for your repentance than that religion. Are you with me, brothers? Allah loves when you repent to Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if the Prophet of Allah did it, لَابُدَّ لِكُلِّ عَبْدٍ أَن يَتُوبَ. Every one of us has to repent and come back to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala from whichever thing that we have done. Ikhwani, tawbah has five conditions. The first one is al-ikhlas, sincerity. You have to be sincere in your repentance. It has to be for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. It has to be out of love for Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. It has to be out of honoring Him, hoping His reward and fear of His punishment. That's the first one. The second one is that the person leaves off the sin. أَيَّتُكَ الْمَعْصِيَةِ. Leave off the sin which you're doing. When we say leave off the sin, we mean if there's anyone who's making you do this sin, stay away from them. If somebody's convincing you into the mistake, get away from them. Whatever's leading you to it also has to be something you abandon. Leave it. Stay away from it and go away from it. Number three. أَيَدَّمَ. Whenever you remember it, regret it. عَلَى فِعْلِ الْمَعَصِيَةِ. There is sinning, the sins that you're doing, and the wronging that you're doing. What do? Regret it when you remember it. A lot of the people glorify their sins. Back in the days, I used to go in with this. That's what they say to you. I used to do it, brother. I went in, you know. It was me, that was me. So I understand. Like, television, enjoying it. Are you with me, brothers? Just talking about it, going back and on it. It's a form of joy in it. It's a regret. You don't want no one to know. You should be stressed about it. When you remember, you're like, "A'udhu billah, I wish Allah concealed it from me in this world and also in the hereafter." Regret. Hate it. Number four is أَن يَعْزِبَ أَن لَا يَعُودَ إِلَيَّ عَبَدًا. That the person, he makes the decision, unwavering conviction, "I'm never going to do this again. I am not going to do this sin again." He makes that decision in his heart that he's never going to go back to that sin again. Number five is that the repentance is done in the permitted time. There's a time when it's not permitted. أَن تَكُونَ التَّوْبَةُ فِي وَقْتِهَا الْمُقَدَّرَ. The time when it is allowed for you to repent. مَنْ تَابَ قَبْلَ أَن تَطْلُعَ الشَّمْسَ شَمْسُ مِنْ مَغْرِبِهَا تَابَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ. Anyone who repents before the sun rises from the opposite direction, his repentance is accepted. But if the sun comes out from the opposite direction and you repent, there's no point, it's gone. Also the Prophet said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَتُوبُ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَقْبَلُ تَوْبَةَ الْعَبْدِ مَا لَمْ يُغَرْغِرْ. Allah accepts the tawbah of the person before the nafs reaches here. Too late now. Repentance is too late. Those are the two times when you have to be careful. Now,
narrated by Ibn Umar radiyallahu anhuma, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam enjoined the payment of one sa'a of dates or one sa'a of barley as zakat al-fitr on every Muslim slave or free, male or female, young or old, and he ordered that it be paid before the people went out to offer the Eid prayer.
عن عبد الله بن عمر رضي الله عنهما قال فرض رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم زكاة الفطر صاعا من التمر أو صاعا من شعير على العبد والحر والذكر والأنثى والصغير والكبير من المسلمين وأمر بها أن تؤدى قبل الخروج الناس إلى الصلاة.
This hadith shows that zakat al-fitr is obligatory. It's obligatory on the young, على الصغير, the one who's young, على الكبير, the one who's old, على الذكر والأنثى, the male and the female, الحر والعبد, the slave and the free one, from the Muslims. And it is, the purpose for it is طهرة للصائم, it's a purification for the fasting one, وطعمة للمساكين, and it is also food for the poor and the needy, for the day of Eid, to enjoy themselves. And it is also to come with this characteristic of generosity and righteousness. And it is also to express shukr, gratitude. It's to express gratitude to Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala that He allowed you to finish Ramadan and to also pray Qiyam al-Layl. The amount that everybody has to pay is what? Sa'a al-Ta'am. It's a sa'a of food. It could be bur, it could be sha'ir, it could be tam, it could be zabib, it could be aqatin. Aqatin is a dry yogurt. Or any other food that's eaten from the place that you're from, where you're from. Good. The person pays it when Ramadan is complete. Qabla salatul Eid, before the salatul Eid. That's the best. It is best that is done when Ramadan finishes, but before Salatul Eid, that is better. It is also permissible to bring it forward 1 or 2 days earlier. You're allowed to, based on the action of some of the companions. And Imam Ahmad in his Masail, by Abi Dawud, Abi Dawud al-Sijistani, he asked Imam Ahmad questions. And he said, Sami'tu Ahmad al-Su'ula. Abi Dawud said, I heard Imam Ahmad being asked, "An zakat al-fitr, the zakat al-fitr, qabla salat, before the prayer." قال كان ابن عمر أبو أحمد said عبد الله بن عمر he used to يخرجها قبل الفطر he used to give it out before the fitr بيوم أو يومين 1 or 2 days before it. That's the was narrated. That is what. As for the intrinsic of the issue of zakat al-fitr, I've explained it more in my I made a series on zakat al-fitr last year Ramadan. You can also watch it, it's 4 parts, I think, 4 or 5 parts. So they take money instead. The money can't be made into the zakat, even the brothers. But it has to be converted into. So if they take it from you on the basis that they're going to convert it to food, then it should be converted into food. Okay? Because the time of the Prophet said money was there, and they didn't use money. They used what? Food. So if these masajid are taking it from you, they have to take responsibility and you have to make sure that they do it a day or two before. It's permissible. Are you there? Or the day before, the day when it's Eid. As for if, what about Eid is celebrated at your place or what, and another country they celebrate it differently from you, I've explained that all in the series that I made, 4-part series I made. I think it would be better for all of you to go in, it was very detailed. If I stay, Mr. Kamal, if I stay, then next week, inshallah, one of the things we can do, we go inshallah.